One reason why we wanted to have this conversation tonight is because we know a lot of students on campus are wrestling with these types of issues. When we go to science classes, how does that square with what we learned in our churches and our Bible studies and those sorts of things? So we wanted to have a discussion to help students who are themselves wrestling with this and those in the community. We also wanted to have this event because we think Reasons to Believe and BioLogos both model the type of conversation that followers of Christ can have. They don't agree on every topic. They agree on a lot of topics, but not everyone. But the way in which they talk with each other and display graciousness is a good example to us all. So let me say a brief word of introduction, but they're going to introduce themselves in a little bit more detail. Dr. Harzma is an experienced research scientist. She has numerous publications in astronomy, in a field in which she completed her doctoral work at MIT. She has previously served as professor and chair in the Department of Physics and Astronomy at Calvin College in Michigan. She currently serves as president of BioLogos, which you'll hear about tonight, which provides virtual and actual meeting places where the best Christian minds in the sciences and other fields meet on topics of mutual interest for the good of the church. She is a co-author with her husband of the book Origins, Christian Perspectives on Creation, Evolution, and Intelligent Design, which is on sale in the back as you leave tonight. We're also pleased to welcome Dr. Hugh Ross. Dr. Ross is also an astronomer and founder and president of Reasons to Believe, an organization dedicated to demonstrating the compatibility of science and Christianity. Hugh earned his BS in physics from the University of British Columbia and MS and PhD in astronomy from the University of Toronto. While in college, he dedicated himself to faith in Christ following an in-depth study of scripture that convinced him of the Bible's factual accuracy. Today, Hugh is the author of multiple books, such as Why the Universe is the Way It Is, and speaks on science and faith issues to audiences around the world. And so we also have many DVDs and publications from Reasons to Believe in the back. And I actually believe there is some pamphlets going around, and if you actually, I know for the Reasons to Believe side, if you sign up, you get a free DVD in the back. Okay? So this is how we'll go tonight. We'll want it to be not overly formal, so Dr. Ross, Dr. Harzma, if you would like to come up. And what I'll do is I'll ask questions, but they've had many conversations, as you've heard before. So they're very comfortable discussing back and forth and asking questions back and forth to each other. So we will do this for about 55 minutes, and then the last 25, 30 minutes we'll have questions from the audience. Okay? The last thing to say is that we have also passed around evaluations, which is important for us as we report back to our grant agencies. So towards the end, if you'd fill that out and leave it, there's a cardboard box as you leave in the back. If you could leave that there. There's a prayer box. Don't leave it in there. We made that mistake before. But in the cardboard box, leave it there, okay? So let's get started. So the first question to ask is, I guess, tell us more about yourself. What's your Christian background? I think would be the first thing to start off. And then what's your scientific background? How did you get into science? What led you there? And how did you, basically your background story. So we'll start with Dr. Ross and then we'll alternate. All right, let's try the push the button. How about this? Why don't you hold this for a second? Why?
How's that? Oh, wow, that's a lot better. Okay. I'll start over again. Born, raised, and educated in Canada, not raised in a Christian home. Didn't really get to know Christians until I showed up at Caltech at age 27. And I got into astronomy seriously when I was seven. That's when I started reading about five books a week on physics and astronomy. And knew from the age of eight that that would be my future career. And so I wound up, like Deb, doing a lot of research on quasars and galaxies. And it was while at Caltech. Now, by the way, I became a Christian through my astronomy. My astronomy persuaded me that the universe had a beginning, that the Big Bang model was pointing to a beginning and therefore a beginner. And that led me on a search through the great philosophers, which I found quite disappointing, which caused me to look at the different holy books of the religions of the world and began to go through them and was especially impressed with the Bible, how it had actually predicted Big Bang cosmology thousands of years before it was discovered. I was particularly impressed that the account of creation in Genesis 1 was correctly described in the correct chronological sequence and recognized that the Bible was consistently and accurately predicting future scientific discoveries, which led me, after a two-year study, to sign my name in the back of a Gideon Bible that I got in the public school, giving my life to Christ. Began to immediately share my faith with my fellow students and professors. I saw some come to Christ, including some colleagues at Caltech. But it was while I was at Caltech that another astronomer there who was a Christian basically challenged me to share my Christian faith with non-scientists. I immediately asked him, where can I find these non-scientists? And he said, try walking off the Caltech campus. And he was right, there actually were some off the Caltech campus. And I actually just would talk to total strangers on the street and was amazed how receptive they were and how they were coming to Christ. Wound up launching some Bible studies, planted a church. Church I was attending basically put me on their staff to train people how to use science as a tool to bring people to faith in Christ. And that church helped me launch Reasons to Believe. And Reasons to Believe is an organization that we founded to proclaim new reasons to believe in Christ through emerging scientific discoveries and through building what we call a testable creation model, recognizing that the big objection to Christianity among scientists is they don't think it's testable or falsifiable or predictive. And so we built and have been continuing to build a testable, falsifiable creation model and using it as a tool to bring scientists, but also lay people around the world to faith in Christ.
Dr. Harper.
Yes, so my story is a little different, although we ended up in a similar sort of place. I grew up in a Christian home in Minnesota. I went to an evangelical church, and so I learned from an early age to put my faith in Christ, and I learned that Jesus loves me. As I grew older, that commitment became stronger. I also got very interested in science and math, and my family encouraged that. I went off to graduate school, and it was at that stage I started to get interested in astronomy and began to wonder then how I was going to fit that with the Bible, because in my upbringing, we all assumed the young Earth creation view of things, that the Earth and the universe was made about 10,000 years ago in 6 24-hour days, and we didn't know of any other Christian options. But in graduate school, as I began learning the evidence for the age of the Earth and the age of the universe, I started to ask the questions then about the Bible. How am I going to hang on to the Bible? And began to read some biblical scholars there and came to understand much more about the cultural context in which the ancient Israelites lived and how that scripture was written and more about what God was doing in there. And I came to understand ways to hold to the authority and inspiration of scripture, continue to take it seriously, and that ended up growing in my faith through that. And as I began to understand the universe better, I grew in my understanding of who God is. During my time as a professor at Calvin College, I did a lot of working with students on issues of science and faith, and that led to the book that my husband and I wrote. And then BioLogos was founded. I wasn't part of it at the founding. It was founded by Francis Collins, Dr. Collins is one of the world's leading biologists. He led the Human Genome Project, and he currently directs the National Institutes of Health. And he wrote out his testimony of how he became a Christian as an adult in the book, The Language of God. And the response he got to that book, he got so many questions from people across the board that he founded BioLogos to be a place where people can ask questions of how great science and biblical faith can fit together, how an evolutionary understanding of God's creation can fit with the Bible, and how one can pursue a career in science without giving up one's faith. So BioLogos now has a very rich website, lots of resources. I encourage you to check it out.
So I'm sure we'll get into some of the areas in which your two organizations and think about Genesis and the evolutionary narrative differently, but why don't we start off by talking about what are some similarities that you see between your two organizations? Dr. Harshman?
Yeah, what would be the biggest one? Probably because we're both astronomers, so we both accept the evidence for the great age of the universe and the great age of the Earth, and that's big, and your organization's been so strong at bringing that message to churches and helping them understand the scientific evidence. So that'd be the biggest one. What else? What other similarities do we have?
Well, I think we're both organizations are committed to dialogue in the spirit of 2 Corinthians 5:20. And we're both concerned that we model before the Christian community how two organizations can sharply disagree and yet treat one another in the spirit of charity. And I see this as an evangelistic principle. 2 Corinthians 5 says that we're ambassadors for peace, to call non-Christians to come to peace with God. But how can that happen if we can't come to peace with one another? And so non-Christians watch us. And that's actually a key, from our perspective, that's a key evangelistic foundation. We have to demonstrate our capacity to make peace with one another if we're going to challenge non-Christians to make peace with God.
Yeah, we agree. It's just so important that we because in that gracious conversation, that is how we display the fragrance of Christ and how we show the unity that we have as Christians. And unity doesn't mean uniformity. We don't have to agree on everything, but that underlying Christian unity should be there. So, and I guess a third area of agreement is we both take the Bible very seriously. The Bible is God's authoritative and inspired word, and that's very central to all we do at BioLogos and everything at Reasons to Believe.
Yeah, I think we also share our commitment to the Belgic Confession, Article 2, mm-hmm. that God's given us two books, and we're to treat both books seriously. I mean, in our church, I keep reminding people that we're commanded in the Bible to be theologians. We're also commanded to be scientists. So it's not just for us professionals. All Christians should be engaged in studying the book of nature, and all Christians should be engaged in studying the book of Scripture.
Yeah. I was just rereading C.S. Lewis's Mere Christianity, and he pointed out there how being a Christian actually strengthens your intellectual capacity because we're called to study and to learn about God and His Word and in the natural world.
Well, that's actually part of our creation model, that once you form a relationship with a higher being, that actually releases your potential to a greater area. And just like we see that in the birds and mammals, when they form a bond with us, their capacities are enhanced. Likewise, we argue that takes place for the one who commits himself to their creator.
Yeah, I think that's probably right.
So let's ask a question about interpreting Scripture. And Dr. Rush, you already addressed this a little bit, but is there any places in the Bible when you read passages, do you say, there's a modern scientific theory there that you see in Scripture that somehow has to be supernaturally there because in some ways they're giving theories or knowledge that we would not realize is true until much later?
Well, I noticed that the very first time I picked up the Bible. I was 17 at the time, started in Genesis 1, began to go through it and said, everything here is correctly stated with respect to the latest science. And I was particularly impressed. It was all in the correct chronological sequence. What also impressed me is I could see in that first page the scientific method. I mean, step one, don't interpret until you establish the point of view. And that's right there in Genesis 1, 2. Step two, don't interpret till you see the starting conditions. That's also there in Genesis 1:2. And so what I realize is right from the very first page, I'm seeing statements written thousands of years ago that are far beyond the science of its time, and everything it says is true. And so I began to go through the Bible and discovered that you see that over and over again. As an astronomer, I was impressed that I found passages that say that we live in a universe that expands, is stretching out of the heavens, how it's stretched out like a tent, and how there's a space-time beginning to the universe, how the laws of physics don't change, how there's a pervasive law of decay. And so as a young astronomer, I said, the Bible's implying we live in a universe that gets colder and colder as it gets older and older. And so I realized that no scientist had even hinted of a Big Bang universe until the 20th century. 1925 is the first time. And yet we got Bible authors, six different Bible authors, stating this thousands of years ago. And so it was the predictive power of the Bible that was a huge step in persuading me to give my life to Jesus Christ.
Yeah, so at Biologos, we look at those passages a little differently. So we're a network at Biologos. We have a faith statement on our website that we affirm the authority and inspiration of Scripture. But we have quite a few biblical scholars in our network, and we don't all agree on exactly all the nuts and bolts. But a big theme that we have among biblical scholars, and most of us at Biologos, is understanding the Bible as an ancient text. And the ancient peoples did not know modern science, and so we don't see that God's revelation there is pointing to modern scientific discoveries. Those passages where it talks about the heavens stretching out like a tent, we think refer to the cultural context of the people at the time, where they thought the sky really was like a roof over their heads, like a tent covering the sky, a physical object upholding an ocean of water above it. And so those passages seem to be pointing to that worldview rather than to our modern understanding of the expansion of the universe.
Aren't you impressed, though, that Jewish theologians 800, 900, 1,000 years ago also saw that in the text? So I don't think it's just us modern astronomers reading it in the mm-hmm. Bible. People long before these discoveries were made studied the Bible and came to these conclusions.
Yeah, I think I would say that I want to go with the best biblical scholarship out there, which is pointing more in that direction. There's a lot of things we can see in Scripture. What was it? One of my pastors said, there's the Sermon on the Mount that Jesus gives, and then there's the sermon where he's on the plain. And do you read significance into that? Well, probably not. So when do you read significance into something and when not? We have to go with what was important to them at the time. And so I think that's going to be the guiding criteria.
Yeah, we take a little different view. We believe the Bible's inspired for all generations, and
right,
therefore we
yeah.
don't see that any generation has some special significance over other generations. This being the Holy Spirit, he wants it to communicate to all humanity, and that's one reason why we explain why the Bible is silent on Neanderthals. That would be a term that would not be familiar to people who lived before us.
Huh. But the expanding universe was not familiar to them either.
Well, they would be able to understand the terminology. You throw the word Neanderthal in,
well,
they're not going to know what it means.
That's true.
But if you throw in the expansion, they're going to know what that means.
Hmm.
And I was particularly impressed that the verb natah shows up in all three Hebrew verb forms.
Well, the verb what?
That's the verb that's translated the stretching out.
Oh.
It literally means expansion.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the English translations don't have it quite what the Hebrew has there. And with the three verb forms, it really takes away the idea that it's simply a metaphor. It literally is, and it's something that Jewish theologians picked up on hundreds of years ago, that with the three different Hebrew verb forms, it literally is talking about a universe that's being expanded.
Okay.
So.
Well, yeah, so this is one area where we have a different view. Was there something else in that question?
Yeah, let me ask, it's kind of the flip side. Is there any places, any passages in Scripture where you can point to and say, this is the science of their time, but now we know that's not how it works? Is there any places where, in some ways, their view of the natural world is limited to the time and the cultures in which they lived? And if so, does that bring up questions about the reliability or trustworthiness of Scripture?
Well, I was confronted with that with a debate that I had with Michael Shermer about a decade ago, where he said, Hugh, Genesis has got it dead wrong because it puts the land plants before the sea animals.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that.
My response was, well, Michael, these animals have shells and skeletons, so we expect them to be well preserved over, you know, hundreds of millions of years, but not the plants. But what's interesting is that there have been papers published back in 2009 and 2011 where they found first the isotope evidence and later the actual fossils that indeed plants on the continents predate the animals in the oceans literally by 600 million years. And so what we see is that the Bible indeed did get the chronology right. However, 10 years ago, we said we don't have the evidence, but we have good reasons why we don't have the evidence, but today we have the actual evidence. So yeah, I don't know anywhere in the Bible where there would be a conflict with what established science is stating. Now, when I say that, when I went through the Bible, I basically said, if I can find a provable error contradiction, then I know this is not inspired by God. And I did find passages in the Bible that were puzzling, but I couldn't find a provable error contradiction, and I still can't find a provable error contradiction. You got one you want to suggest?
Jesus said the mustard seed was the smallest seed.
Well, the smallest of your seeds. I mean, many translations put it that way. I mean, what's the context of what Jesus was saying? That's in the context of a provable error. And what's interesting on the debate of Michael Shermer, his biblical hermeneutic.
Who is Michael Shermer?
He's the executive director of the Skeptic Society, you know, well-known public atheist here in the U.S. And what I notice is his way of reading the Bible, how can I put it in the worst possible light? Whereas my approach is, how can I put it in the best possible light? And to be honest, that's how I treated the Hindu Vedas, the Quran, and all the other holy books. Put them in the best possible light, and when I did, I couldn't defend them. But with the Bible, no problem.
Okay, so when Jesus said the mustard seed was the smallest seed, I think he clearly was accommodating his statement to the idioms and the knowledge of the people at the time. He wasn't going to try to explain that there were many other smaller seeds. And so maybe the smallest of your seeds is implied in there. I think there are many places in Scripture where God's accommodating his message to the limited scientific understanding that people had at the time. So in Genesis 1, on the second day, it says God set up the firmament, the solid dome sky, to separate the waters above from the waters below. And man, as a kid, I had no idea what that meant. What was this firmament thing? What was this ocean up there? And then I learned that the people back then really thought that's how the world was. And so, to me, that's God accommodating his message to their understanding, putting it in terms they would understand, even though it isn't what we now know to be the case, that the sky is a gaseous atmosphere.
Yeah, our approach to that is, number one, it's a very brief statement in Genesis 1. Water above and water below. What does that mean? Well, when you go to the book of Job, you've got 1.5 chapters that expand on creation day 2. So there you got a very detailed account of what God's doing on day 2. And if you actually go through that chapter and a half, chapter 37 and 38, it mentions 16 different kinds of precipitation. So it seemed really clear that what God is telling us about in creation day 2 is all the effort and design he put into setting up just the right water cycle so that we could have human civilization or the entire planet. I mean, I live in California. If all we had was rain, we'd be in trouble. But we have snow.
You need that snowpack, don't you?
We need that snowpack. And what's interesting about Job 37 is it mentions how critical it is to have multiple forms of liquid precipitation and frozen precipitation. And I believe that Job is older in its content than Genesis, probably by 500 or 600 years. There's good textual evidence of that, which means that Moses could get away with making a very cryptic statement because he would know the people already had a whole chapter and a half in an earlier revelation.
Okay, well, not to get into all the details of all that, not to respond to all that, but I did want to make a comment about something you said earlier about how the Bible has given us a basis for the scientific approach. And I think that is true in a lot of ways. You have God asking Adam to name the animals, and naming things is a big thing that we do as scientists. And we have God talking about the regularity of nature, the fixed laws of heaven and earth, and how he set that up. That's in Jeremiah 33. God pointing to the regularity of nature is something we should study. And there's such a wonderful basis we have in our Christian faith for doing science, and that's another area where we agree.
All right. We have a question now about evolution. So evolution is a theory with a lot of different parts. There's the questions of mechanism, of common descent, of microevolution versus macroevolution. So what parts of evolutionary theory, I'll start with you, Dr. Harsma, do you find convincing? And then what parts are speculative or unproven at this point, would you say?
Yeah, you're right that the word evolution gets used a lot of different ways. So one way it's used very commonly in our culture is just as an atheistic idea that evolution is basically the same as atheism, and there'll be atheists who talk about it that way and Christians who talk about it that way. But for scientists in evolutionary biology, evolution is a scientific process that they would use that word similar to using gravity or photosynthesis or other scientific ideas. Now, as you say, within that, there are still different aspects of the evolutionary process. At Biologos, we find convincing all of those aspects, that there's microevolution that is causing species to diverge, create new species, to modify and adapt to their changing environments. We also accept the evidence and mechanisms for macroevolution, that large changes can happen in species over time. And we enjoy learning and studying about all of the ways that happens. So we find I can go into more detail on particular evidence, but all of the whole scientific picture, we find there's multiple lines of evidence supporting it, and it's an active area of ongoing research.
Yeah, I mean, we're both astronomers, and we typically define evolution as change with respect to time.
Yeah, we're more used to talking about galaxy evolution and
stellar evolution. Yeah. So. And we're both old enough that we've experienced change with respect to time in our bodies, so
yeah,
we've evolved.
Gray hair,
so,
yes.
In my case, a little more so than you, but so no question about the time scale it reasons to believe. We believe that life has been here for 3.8 billion years, that it started simple, it became complex. Like Deb, I accept microevolution, but we're all at reasons to believe skeptical about macroevolution. And so we would look to things like long-term evolution experiments as a way to test our differences. And we ask for more of those experiments to be done, but so far we see that it's contradicting the evidence for macroevolution. And then we look at the origin of life. It seems that the evidence is now very compelling that the origin of life happened without the benefit of prebiotic molecules. If you don't have prebiotics, you don't have a naturalistic explanation. So it seems a clear case where God stepped in.
Yeah, and on that first life question, we would agree that there's not a strong scientific model for that yet, but we're in the wait and see mode to see what will come of ongoing research as far as
What makes us a little uncomfortable. Yeah. If you got clear evidence that there's no home or chiral source, if you got clear evidence there's no prebiotics, and there's very little time for the origin of life, how can you say there's a naturalistic explanation? All naturalistic models require building blocks.
Well, we're not saying there is a natural explanation. We're saying that people are still investigating it. It's not an area I've read up on a lot, so I can't say too much about some of the details you mentioned there.
Well, that is a distinction we hold at Reasonably. We see that as a supernatural act. Mm-hmm. And moreover, we see that as the simplest problem for the biological evolutionists to solve, because all you got is physics and chemistry. And so that should be the easiest place for them to make their case, and yet it's quite clear that they're in trouble on that one. And what's been amazing to me is attending these Origin of Life research conferences is how depressing the meetings are. I mean, you and I have been to astronomical meetings. They're always crackling with excitement.
And
there's a lot of enthusiasm for what's mm-hmm. being published. You go to an Origins Life research meeting, and each meeting gets more depressing than the last meeting. So, that tells you that their models aren't going well, the fact that you see such a strong mood of depression, where you actually have people getting up at the microphone and saying, we've eliminated all possibilities except intelligent aliens bringing life here to planet Earth, which I find encouraging. I do think somebody came here to planet Earth to make life, just not from another planet.
So it sounds like for you to find evolution convincing, you would need a good theory of the origin of life.
Well, I would need not only a good theory, I would need to see it backed up with real-time experiments. I mean, the history of life is only billions of years. So over the course of 20, 30 years, we should be able to develop confirming experiments. And when those experiments are done, they don't verify the theoretical model. And there's also something else I see valuable in that. From a biblical perspective, God creates for 6 days, he rests on the seventh day. What that tells me as a Christian, if I do an experiment in the human era, all I'm going to see is natural process. So if I see something in my real-time experiments that's at odds of what I see in the past, then I know there isn't a continuum back into the past. So that would verify that's where we would see divine intervention. So I'd argue, in order to make their case, their experiments have to verify their theory.
I just want to point out that this whole challenging question of first life is distinct from the rest of the evolutionary process. So Darwin's model and evolutionary biologists are focused on once you have single-celled life, and then how can it develop from there? And then, so that's the part that we're seeing the abundant evidence for.
Yeah, and where I'm arguing about the time scales, there's events over the 3.8 billion years that happen extremely rapidly, where you got a mass speciation event less than 10,000 years after a mass extinction event. Therefore, a 30-year-long experiment should tell you whether or not the evolutionary paradigm can explain that transition.
Wouldn't know about that. I would agree, there's major transitions in the evolutionary process. One thing that one of our scholars has talked about, Jeff Schloss, he's pointed to the research in the secular biology community of the big changes that happen in evolution, and there are these mass extinction events. But another way of thinking of it is major changes in growth of cooperation. So you have single-celled life. The transition to multicellular life required cooperation. Evolution isn't just about competition and survival of the fittest. That's a pretty limited way of looking at it. So you have single-celled to multicellular life cooperation. You have individuals in a species learning to cooperate with others in their species. So you have beavers building dams and ants building anthills, and they're making changes to their environment, working together. And then you have before that would be the transition from asexual reproduction to sexual reproduction, and with that a growth in variety and complexity of species. And finally, at the end, you have the primate social behavior, the cooperation that's involved there. And then human cooperation is a whole other level beyond that, of the way we're able to cooperate once we have language, communicating and trading across the globe. So it's another way of telling the story of evolution.
Yeah, some other ways you can put it to the test is you got the fossil record. If the evolutionary paradigm is correct, it should match the molecular clocks. So it's another way of putting it to the test. Mm-hmm. You can also look at the morphology of the bodies and compare that with what's happening at the level of the mind and the emotions of the animals. And so our critique at Reasons to Believe is that these different methods of challenging the evolutionary paradigm are not giving consistent results.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Because for us, what we're seeing is those lines of evidence, the fossil evidence, the body morphology evidence, and the genetics are all pointing to the same big picture of common ancestry of the species, of the interrelation of all of them and the development over time?
Well, a couple of examples. I mean, you can get a date for the Cambrian explosion through fossils. Mm-hmm. The molecular clock is 200 million years earlier. They should be consistent if the evolutionary paradigm is correct. And that's just one of literally dozens of examples where the molecular clock dates are out of sync with the fossil record dates.
I'm not familiar with molecular clock dates.
And then the other challenge is when you look at the higher cognitive capacities, if humans and chimps, for example, are related to a recent common ancestor, then the chimps should have the closest properties of the mind to humans, but they don't. It's birds that are closest to us, not the great apes. And so what you see is, ravens far surpass the great apes in intellectual capability.
But the primates would be most similar to us in a lot of, in a more broad view of the intellectual capacities and social behavior, I would think.
No, that's not the case. I mean, for example, ravens can take a tool to recover a completely different tool, to recover a third tool, to get a food treat. The primate can only do step one. It can't do step two and three. And the raven does this without any training. And the raven can solve puzzles that the primates are not able to solve. And it's not just the ravens. You see this with jays, the whole family of corvids. And what you notice, too, is the brain structure of these birds most closely matches that of humans, not with the primates.
Okay, well, we're getting beyond where I've read, so I can't contribute too much more at this point.
Yeah, I wanted to follow up a question on, in terms of, I think this falls in terms of trusting science, especially for students who are not trained in the sciences. On the one hand, I feel like as astronomers, you would say the consensus of science says the Earth or the universe is old, and so we should trust the consensus of science. But on the other hand, I think we would also say the consensus of biologists is that evolution happened, but yet you take different views about whether that's actually true. So, especially as students not trained in the sciences, how do we know what to trust? When should we accept consensus? When should we not accept consensus?
Yeah, I've actually written articles on that, making the point that you need to see what's happening to the error bars with respect to time. Always look at the error bars. Always look at the systematic errors as well as the random errors. Often in biology, they just simply ignore the systematic errors. You know, we're in astronomy. We realize you always have to look at both. So you want to do that. You want to see what happens to both the systematics and the randoms. You also want to make sure that you're looking at a paradigm that's supported by a combination of experiments, observations, and theory. And where you're seeing anomalies, you let the anomalies play out, because often there'll be multiple theories explaining the observations. All right, let's see how that develops. In astronomy, we've got good examples. Mm-hmm. There was a time when stars were measuring older than the universe.
Yes.
And so we knew we were missing something. Mm-hmm. Well, likewise, we're arguing at reasons to believe there are anomalies like that in biology, which should basically cause us to say, you know, this is where we need to do more research.
And we still think that evolutionary biology is an active area of research and that there are anomalies being found all the time and people are working them out. A lot of them have been resolved. So one example is whale evolution. So whales and dolphins are mammals living in the water. How did they get there? And the evolution predicts that, well, they must be more closely related to other mammals which live on land rather than fish. But for a long time, the transition fossils weren't known for this, of how the land animals actually became whales and dolphins. And in recent years, those have been found, more and more of them. So it's filling in that understanding. And so when we see these anomalies, we think, well, you know, let's keep looking, let's keep refining and understanding it better.
Yeah, but I think the point is when you're trying to communicate to students, when you can be certain of a scientific result, okay. If there's an anomaly, we should wait. On the other hand, there will always be anomalies, but if the anomalies are getting smaller and smaller and less significant, you can be fairly confident you're on the pathway to truth. Mm-hmm. If it's going the opposite way, you've got cause to be doubtful of the result. And again, if you don't have a concordance between experiments, observations, and theory, that's a clear sign we need to wait.
And I would agree with those principles,
right. And then scientific consensus. I mean, if you've got 99.999% of the scientists saying this is the way it is, they've probably got good reasons for being so certain.
I would agree with that.
But if 10% are saying no, then maybe they've got a good reason why they're right and the 90% are wrong.
And I think it's smaller than that, though, among evolutionary biologists. So we would see that it's an even higher percentage among evolutionary biologists.
Yeah, well, we see a different percentage, but the fact that we see differences, again, is something that should be explored. Yeah. Where are the differences and how are we asking the questions?
Yeah, so we have different assessments of the scientific field.
Do you think your disagreement in the way you interpret certain passages? Is it more a matter of theology where you disagree more, or is it more a matter of science? Is it more, where's the more
third
agreement?
Option of biblical hermeneutic approach? Or?
Yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking in terms of theology. So where would you kind of put your finger on where exactly the nub of, in some ways, the disagreement is?
The overall disagreement, yeah. Or the disagreement? Yeah, overall, you know, that I've been wondering that actually. And I think most of the time I walk into our dialogues thinking that the biggest area of disagreement is the scientific. But then there's some of just, you know, our approach to how we think about how the Bible and the science work together that's also different. So,
well, you know, in our dialogue over the past 8 years of BioLogos, we began by thinking our greatest differences are scientific. Mm-hmm. Our opinion now is our greatest differences are biblical, not mm-hmm. scientific. Mm-hmm. And it's mainly, you know, getting to engage the theologians that are part of your team and being able to actually talk through the theological issues, mm-hmm. realizing that we take a very different hermeneutic approach to the Bible.
Yeah,
and
that's
so
what we were
finding
too.
I think that's probably
too.
Accurate, that yeah. that's where our biggest differences lie.
Yeah, I think so.
So in line with the hermeneutic question, how would you interpret what's going on in Genesis 1 and 2? Can you say a little bit more about how you would approach those stories and how you make sense of them in light of your faith and in light of science? Dr. Harsman, would you start?
Oh, let me start. So I said a little bit already about how the ancient people understood the world around them. And the ancient Hebrews, Egyptians, Babylonians all thought the earth was flat and there was this solid dome. But the Egyptians and Babylonians also saw it populated with a whole pantheon of gods, the sky god, the earth god, the sun god, the sea god. And so when the ancient Israelites would first have heard this account in Genesis 1, it would sound very familiar to them, like, oh, yeah, we're talking about, yep, there's the light and the dark, the sea and the sky. That all makes sense. We're used to understanding there's a firmament. But what would have really stood out for them is that it didn't have this pantheon of gods. There wasn't the Egyptian god of the sun. There was one God, Yahweh, who created all things, who created a greater light. But, you know, the text doesn't have that proper name for the sun that they would have associated with the God of the Egyptians. And so that contrast really highlights what the core message of Genesis 1 is, of the goodness of creation, the sovereignty of God, the goodness of humans, the development from the simple to the complex. Those main themes come through, but the spiritual themes are the most important there in those passages. And so when I first learned about that, that gave me some assurance, like, that God wasn't trying to teach science to them. He was trying to explain to them the whole spiritual worldview of how to understand the natural world. So that's kind of the outline of how we approach that passage.
Well, how would you, in light of what you said, then interpret Genesis 2 and the Adam and Eve story?
Ah, okay. So then, and when you get to the Adam and Eve story, the text changes. So Genesis 1 uses different names for God than Genesis 2 and 3. You're getting a second account here of creation, and it's rather different. It starts off with God creating rivers and then humans, and then eventually get to plants. And in that account, you also see a lot of things, some things that have a symbolic element to them, like a talking snake and miraculous trees. And you see phrases and things that resonated in the culture of that time. I recently learned from a biblical scholar pointed out, which I should have seen, you know, that God creating them from the dust. If you think of how the word dust is used elsewhere in Scripture, it refers to mortality. That we are created from, from dust you are, and to dust you shall return. And just having that insight, you know, God is creating these humans in that context from the beginning. So we see those passages as also teaching very important truths that are spiritual, referring to important events in the development of human history, but also having some symbolic elements. And I'll just say one other thing about Adam and Eve. At BioLogos, we have fund a lot of scholars and are bringing a lot of people into the conversation about how to understand Adam and Eve. And we don't have one particular view on that. We are trying to foster research and conversations about different ways of understanding Adam and Eve and what are the implications scientifically, biblically, theologically.
Yeah, where we take a difference with BioLogos, we view Genesis 1 and 2 as being historical, as being literal, what they're saying about natural history. And we see that confirmed by the other two dozen creation texts elsewhere in the Bible. And, you know, when I first read Genesis 1 and 2, it's like Moses couldn't have been more obvious that he was trying to give us a chronology of natural events. And so that's probably one of the biggest differences between the two organizations and how we look at these creation texts. Now, we do agree that there's spiritual implications, but we see this fundamentally giving us account, a real account of natural history. And in Genesis 2, referring to a real couple, Adam and Eve, who give rise to all of humanity. And there's many references elsewhere in the Bible that make the point that indeed we're all descended from this one man and this one woman from whom we all inherited sin.
What would you say?
You would see the days in Genesis 1 as being long periods of time, but still happening in exactly that order as stated, right?
Yes, I mean, I see that as part of the literal meaning of the text. I mean, it was clear to me the first time I picked up the Bible that this word day must have at least three different literal definitions, because three are used actually in the first chapter. Genesis 2:4 uses the word day to refer to the entire creation story. And the fact that we don't see an evening and a morning for the seventh day tells me we're still in the seventh day. And actually, if you read Psalm 95, John 5, and Hebrews 4, all three texts tell us we're still in God's seventh day. And it's a day when God no longer creates. And when I first read that at Genesis 17, or when I was 17 years of age, I said, this answers the fossil record enigma. Why we see so many speciation events taking place before humanity and so little after humanity. For 6 days, God creates. On the seventh day, he rests. So I've always been comfortable looking at this text as being a literal account of natural history. And as I mentioned, that was a key factor in my becoming a Christian.
That's actually, you sort of answered the question I was going to ask, but what if you have a student here who says, it looks pretty clear that a day is a 24-hour day, it's a literal reading, I want to read the scripture literally. Why, if it disagrees with science, well, I have God's revelation. Why do I need to even take science to account? So is the answer to that student a biblical argument, or is it more of a scientific argument?
It's a biblical argument. I mean, a clear reading of the text is that these days are six consecutive long periods of time, followed by another long period of time in which God ceases to create. I mean, I saw that at age 17. I was rather stunned the first time I met a young earth creationist. That didn't happen until 9 years later. And my question is, how did you ever get that from the text? It seems so clear that it can't be 24 hours. The fact that there's no evening and morning for the seventh day. And I said, look what happens to Adam on day six. He's created at the end of the sixth day, and yet he goes through three careers before he gets introduced to Eve. And when he is introduced...
What do you say what the three careers are?
Well, first he had to tend the garden. And he had to tend the garden long enough to realize there's more to life than gardening. And this is the Garden of Eden, so that would take a while. And then God had him name all the soulish animals. And these are the animals that God created to serve and please him. And I think what God was saying is, I want you to examine each of these animals and discover how I designed them to serve and please you, each in its own distinct way. Again, that would take time.
Oh, yeah.
And then finally, he goes through surgery, recovers from the surgery, and he's introduced to this new creature. And what you see in the Hebrew coming out of his mouth when he sees Eve is Hapa'am. I looked up all the references in the Old Testament where that word appears over 20 times. The most common translation, at long last. And my wife has a different perspective on it. She says, you know, the reason why God created Adam first, he didn't have a mother to train him how to relate to a wife. And he needed a long course of lessons. And the whole point is what God was doing with Adam is introducing him to the three creates of Genesis 1. In Genesis 1, the first create is for the physical creation. The second create is for the soulish creation. The last create is for the spiritual creation. And oh, so,
okay, so when the word create is actually used in Genesis 1?
Where the word create is actually used in Genesis 1. And in Genesis 2, God takes Adam through the three different creates of Genesis 1. Basically saying, if you're going to relate to this woman, you need to be well-practiced at all three levels. And my wife's comment is the reason why women don't need that, God designed them to have this ability to automatically keep those three areas of their life in balance. You know, women can do that. We men like to specialize. And that can lead to problems in marriage. So, and I've experienced some of those problems myself.
So there's been some argument in, this is a question that I hadn't put on here, but there's been some argument whether science should be in some ways reconstituted as a Christian discipline or a theistic science, sometimes you hear, where Christians can take into account all that they know about the natural world and do a distinctive type of science. Or the people argue against, you know, science is science, whether you're here or you're in China or where you're, whatever culture in, science is science. So how do you think about those issues? To what extent does Christian presuppositions about the world allow to play a role in your science? And to what extent is that really getting away from what science is about?
Oh, so to come up with a Christian version of science today neglects that science started out as a Christian endeavor. The scientific revolution happened in the Christian Europe. So the first leading scientists were Christians themselves who saw this as a Christian activity. And when science is investigating the natural world, that's part of what God calls us to do. Science is using our minds and all of our intellectual capabilities, and that's a part of being made in God's image, is thinking his thoughts after him, understanding how he made things. And we, the scientific process of needing to do experiments, well, as Christians, we know that we are fallen, we're sinful, we don't have all of God's understanding, we've got to do experiments to check what we're doing. So the scientific process itself that now scientists of many worldviews use actually started out as a Christian activity. So I don't think we need to change what we're doing. We are already doing, to do science is to do something that is not, it's not incompatible with our faith. It's very consonant with our faith. Now, there's a lot of scientists out there who are atheists, and some of the loudest voices seem to say, well, in science, you're not referring to God at all, and therefore, you know, well, science is the best kind of knowledge, and so we don't need God. God is just superstition. And it's ignoring that these presuppositions, in order to do science, you don't derive them from science itself. The idea that believing that the world has regular natural processes that can be investigated in a rational manner, well, you don't actually prove that scientifically. You walk in the door saying that's the way the world is. And as Christians, we walk in the door saying the world is full of regular processes because we believe in God's providential care. An atheist just, you know, kind of assumes that. So our assumptions overlap in that area, but they're based in different worldviews. And so Christians of many worldviews can do science together, I believe, and come to the same conclusions, because we are all relying on the same core set of methods. It's just that I, as a Christian, remember and believe the Christian basis for all of those methods. So I think you agree with a lot of that, but not quite all of it. So I'm curious where you're different.
Well, I do agree that we wouldn't have modern science if it wasn't for Christianity. Christianity gave birth to the scientific revolution. And, you know, I came to faith by looking at the different religions of the world. And what I saw in the other religions is something that explains why those worldviews gave scientific sparks, but they were stillborn. You know, like in Hinduism, there's this belief that the world of nature is going to be filled with contradictions. And so that makes it very difficult to do science in a Hindu worldview perspective. But Christianity basically says the world is real, it's consistent, it's harmonious, that if you study it, you will find truth. Of all the holy books, the Bible is the only one that commanded objective testing. I saw subjective testing in some of the books, but not objective testing. And how the Bible actually lays out how we're to put everything to the test, which gave birth to the scientific method. And also would argue that's a great way to do theology. And so we should apply objective testing and follow the biblical testing method in our theology and realize new ideas are going to come up, but we can always put them to the test. But there's also the biblical principle. You don't just test, you figure out what's good and you hold on to what's good. And so as a matter, if Christian science from a Christian perspective is not only discovering what is true, but acting upon what you've now discovered to be true and use that as a platform for discovering more truth. So this is the gift that Christianity has given to the modern world.
Okay, but I have also heard you say that special revelation, what we have from the Bible, should make some difference. I remember when we were in Wake Forest in our dialogue there, I remember hearing that from you or Fuzz, that special revelation, you know, what we are learning in the Bible is going to make our science look a little bit different than what other scientists do. Did I hear that wrong? Or?
Well, maybe what we were talking about is how often different worldviews can stultify the advance of science. Mm. And so what a Christian worldview perspective tells you is that we're to avoid those stultifying traps. Mm. And there's many examples, even in the last 100 years, where science was not progressing because people thought they had the answer.
Right, yeah, and, like the steady state universe.
I'm even thinking of examples of the DNA, the presumption that it was the human genome was 98% junk based on an evolutionary paradigm, and nobody bothered to study it for 35 years. And it's like, okay, if you had a biblical perspective on it, we're to study all things. And so don't just let something go by because it doesn't fit your model. Even if it challenges, and this is something I think astronomy has been good at, is that we have a lot of astronomers that are poking holes at what we think is well established. Mm-hmm. I'm old enough to remember people like Burbage and de Vaucouleurs who basically come up with these wild ideas. And when you talk to them privately, they said, I'm pretty well convinced I'm wrong, but I want you to prove that I'm wrong.
Oh, I hadn't heard that about Burbage. I remember
meeting
him once.
Yeah. So he says, I'm just trying to stick my finger up their nose to make them do their work and make them do it a little better.
Well,
so.
Yeah, and that's been my experience of science, that people who are poking holes and pointing out errors, that's rewarded, that's something that we value in the scientific community, especially if you can show you're right. So I think, it's part of the healthy process.
Well, to me, the irony was a group of physicists that figured out, hey, this junk DNA isn't junk.
And it was physicists?
Yeah, it was physicists who did that. If you look at the history, they basically said, if this is all junk, let's actually apply computer science principles to this and see if we get a greater language complexity of the coding DNA than the non-coding DNA. And were shocked to discover the non-coding DNA had greater language complexity than the coding DNA. And that led all the biochemists saying, we better start doing this research. But literally for a 35-year period, nothing was happening.
So I have one more question, and then we'll open it up to the audience. I think a lot of Christian students naturally are a little bit scared about taking science courses. Should students be scared of taking science? Is that something?
No.
Is there any worry that they should have, or any recommendations that you would give students?
Well, if they fail to take science, they will not be able to appreciate the beauty and the elegance of equations of physics.
Amen. Well, you know that you walk out and you look at the night sky and you have that sense of wonder. Hugh and I get that looking at the equations too. You know, like the beauty in the equations that. These simple equations can describe so much of the world around us is just incredible.
Well, I remember the first physics lecture I got at the University of British Columbia. The professor said, you'll always know what the right answer is. It's the most elegant and the most beautiful equation.
Yeah.
And that proved to be true. But later when I became a Christian, I said, that actually points to God.
Yeah.
Why is the most beautiful and elegant equation always the right answer? Mm-hmm. Unless there's a God who enjoys beauty and elegance.
Yeah, there's this great essay on the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics.
Right.
Why should these beautiful equations actually describe the world? And it's one of the things that I find most amazing and praiseworthy about
God's
creation.
Differential calculus predict phenomena 200 million years in the past and the future? I mean, it just doesn't make sense, but it does.
Yeah.
It's a magic.
Yeah. Anyway, so yes, students should take science courses. And the thing is, though, when you're taking a science course, if you're at a place like Samford that's a Christian university, then you have professors who are people of faith who can help you as you're thinking through what, you know, if the science seems to be in conflict with what you're understanding from faith. And there's a lot of issues to talk about, and forums like this help students work through that. If students are heading off to secular universities, they'll encounter professors sometimes, a small number of them, can be actually very strongly anti-Christian and speak very negatively about students' faith. And it's sad that that happens. I think most of the science professors out there genuinely want to help students learn, but if they're not Christians themselves, they can't address the questions that Christians have. And so that's one big part of the mission of BioLogos, is to help students work through the questions, especially on issues of evolution. And RTB does that so well on issues of astronomy, to help students think through these questions.
Yeah,
so.
I would also add that if you're a Christian, science is not an option. It's a command. The Bible tells us that we're to study the book of nature. It's a revelation from God. So any follower of Jesus Christ must be a scientist. Any follower of Jesus Christ must also be a theologian. And we both encourage you, don't leave it up to us professionals. Get involved. It's fun.
All right, so I'm going to move around and let people ask questions. I would ask that they would be focused questions and also gracious, even if they're questions that are wrestling with a point, make them. We want the same kind of conversation that we've had tonight in the questions.
Hey, so in the school of thought of the literal 24-hour creation days, obviously you have 24-hour, those are set periods of time, set days. In the figurative reading of the Bible of creation, There's a much longer period of time. Is each individual day, be it the first day, second day, third day, are those, you know, set periods of time, or are they just indeterminate? You know, is it each day is 1 million years, or is it each day is 3 million years? Because in my own research, I've never found any sort of set number as to one day equals this number, or, you know, the other day equals this number.
Yeah, at BioLogos, we don't see them as. We see that as part of the story device that the author used to lay it out, and so they probably originally understood them as 24-hour days, but that is not a requirement. That's not the essence of what the passage is teaching us, and the biblical text isn't requiring we accept them as 24-hour days. But you have a much more detailed answer on that.
Yes, I mean, we would say it's important to study the Bible both literally and consistently. And if you take a literal, consistent approach to this issue of the days, they are 6 long periods of time. But your question is, are those days sequential? We see them as sequential. We don't see them as overlapping. There's 6 consecutive long periods of time. I've talked to Hebrew scholars about this, and they tell me there's nothing in the text that would require them to be equal periods of time. And when you contrast this with the scientific record, you do see that the days get shorter and shorter as you go from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. On the other end, there's no basis that there's an exponential step decline. I think that's reading way too much in the text. It's simply 6 consecutive long periods of time where you can make whatever day, whatever period of time works best.
So the question that he asked that y'all were struggled with the most, it seemed, was how you guys' approach is different. What is it that makes your approach different? Is it the science, the difference, the theology, the difference? And just listening, I've never heard you speak before, it occurred to me that it appeared that, and I just want to see if your reaction to this, that your approach, that the differences were presuppositions, that in your approach, science, the accuracy of scientific revelation, for lack of a better word, discovery, was the fixed point that then we take our understanding of Scripture and adapt to that in terms of how we meter something as literal to metaphor to allegory or what have you. Whereas I felt like from you maybe that the biblical, the your presupposition is that the Bible is factual, and so sometimes it feels like there's, just my opinion, a confirmation fallacy of adjusting, you know, of maybe overlooking certain things but emphasizing other things in the science, making the science more adaptive to back up the presupposition that the Bible is factual. You know, so for example, you know, the Bible says these people were there at the tomb versus these people were there at the tomb. Jesus entered into Jerusalem on this day and stayed there that night and cleared the temple versus he left and went back, as it says in a different gospel, and came the next day and cleared the temple. So I'm just asking if it could be that the presuppositions that you bring to it are the lens that become the lens that you're reading it from that make your differences so pronounced on certain things.
Yes, certainly we're coming with some different orientation to how we look at it, different presuppositions. I would not say, however, we are not, and this is really important to me personally, I did not want to change my understanding of Scripture just to match science. I don't think that's what God calls us to. God has revealed himself both in the natural world and in Scripture, and I need to come up with some way of understanding both of those that shows the underlying unity of God's revelation, that these two things, even though they're revealed in very different ways. So when we look at Scripture, I spend a lot of time reading Old Testament scholars, how they're interpreting the Bible on its own terms, looking at the cultural references, the original language, and the interpretation of Genesis 1 I described was all in terms of the ancient Near East culture. It's not, I wouldn't have changed my view of the Bible, of my understanding of it, just because of science. And then we look at science on its own terms. And there are still some issues where I don't see how the biblical scholarship and the science are fitting together, and I'm still wrestling with some of those things, but I don't want to just throw out one and because of what the other is saying. So that's how I would answer that question.
Yeah, in my case, it was science that brought me to the faith that the Bible indeed was a factual text. And, you know, reasons to believe is based on what we call a constructive integrationist hermeneutic, where we believe that the 66 books of the Bible can be constructively integrated. You brought up the example of the Gospels. We look at the four Gospels as books by, you know, different testimonies. And just like in a courtroom, you'd expect the different witnesses to have a different account because they see different parts of the story. Can they be constructively integrated? So I have no problem constructively integrating the Gospel accounts, and I have no problem constructively integrating all 66 books of the Bible. To me, the fact that the Bible is 66 books rather than one, two, or three, like we see in the other religions, is a powerful piece of evidence that this is inspired. How you get 66 books all being constructively integrated is nothing short of a miracle. And likewise, I look at the scientific disciplines in the same way. I reject Hinduism because I see that physics, geophysics, biology, chemistry, they can all be constructively integrated without contradiction. But we also see how all these different scientific disciplines can be constructively integrated with the 66 books of the Bible. So I don't really see any area where they can't be constructively integrated. And I wouldn't say that any one book or discipline is superior to another. They do address different subject matter. But to me, this debate about, you know, do we give priority to science or do we give priority to theology, it would be like saying, I'm going to give priority to Romans over priority to Hebrews. No, they're both the inspired and errant word of God. They're both the perfect error word of God. They address different subject matter, but you can't say one is better than the other. Just like I can't say physics is better than chemistry. And likewise, and you see this in the Bible. God gave us two books, the book of nature and the book of Scripture. Both are declared to be utterly trustworthy and reliable, And basically the Bible challenges to put both to the test to show that they are utterly trustworthy and reliable.
Well, as a biologist, I can say biology is the best. But I have a question on just on life science in general. I think I know maybe how you might answer this question, Dr. Harsma. But if the way I read Genesis 2, it seems to say, not it seems to say, it says explicitly, I believe, that the first man was created, and then the animals were created, and then the first woman was created. Do you believe that order is the correct order?
No. So I see Genesis 1 and Genesis, I believe Hughes sees Genesis 2 as an extension of day 6, but I would see Genesis 1 and Genesis 2 as two separate accounts where the events are actually happening in a different orders. Psalm 104, the events happen in yet another order, and none of them are lining up with the order that we know from science. But what I do see in Genesis 1 especially is the inspired human writer there has arranged the text in this beautiful pairs of 3 days. So on day 1 you have light, and day 2 you have the sky and the water, and day 3 you have the dry land. And then days 4, 5, and 6 parallel that. And in each of those structures, they're filling them with living, moving creatures. And it's so there's days of forming and days of filling, and that beautiful symmetry there suggests to me that the human author was not trying to convey a scientific thing here, but something that's showing the order of creation and the beauty of it, and something that would be easy for people to understand and remember. Those kinds of things, I think, were governing the choice of the order of events.
Yeah, and I'd say you need to look at the Hebrew carefully to see where chronology is implied and where it is not. I mean, in Genesis 1, you've got the sequence of the 6 days. You've got the phrase, "and it was so." That's a chronological tool in the Hebrew language. And so the question you need to ask, okay, what is in a chronological sequence in Genesis 1? What is not in a chronological sequence in Genesis 2? And ask that same question for both Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. And what you discover is something interesting. In Genesis 1, the physical events are in a strict chronology, but not the relational events or the discussion about authority and responsibility. When you go to Genesis 2, it's the opposite. The physical events are highly abbreviated and are not in a chronological order. However, the relational events and the assignment of authority and responsibility are in a strict chronology. So looking carefully at the Hebrew clues as to what is in a chronology and what is not, I think helps you to develop a consistent interpretation. Also understand, why are there two side-by-side accounts of creation? Each one has a different purpose. Genesis 1 is focusing on the physical events. Genesis 2 is focusing on the relational or the spiritual events. And so this helps us to understand what is our responsibility in managing the creation. And there's where I think the book of Job helps. The book of Job not only gives you a lot of amplification on the physical events that you see in Genesis 1, it also targets what you see at the end of Genesis 1, where God says, "I'm putting you in charge to manage the planet and all of its resources for the benefit of all life." A single sentence, but you go to the book of Job, you got 3 whole chapters basically laying out how we're to care for creation. And therefore, that helps us in the interpretation of the text in Genesis.
Three years ago, in the Letters of Nature, it made the conclusion that mitochondrial Eve and Y chromosome Adam actually lived at the same time. And they made the conclusion that all men go back to one man, and that all of mankind goes back to one particular woman. Now, they didn't go on to say that these were the only two, but isn't it unusual that there was one man that everybody, all the men in here, go back to, and there's one woman that everybody in this room relates to, and that occurred many thousands of years ago? I was wondering what your thoughts were on that study.
So we have a lot of material on this on the BioLogos website. Yes, so the science is pointing back to where did that first Y chromosome come from? Well, it came, you can trace it back to, there was one man who had that Y chromosome. However, there were a lot of other men living at the time. There was also a lot of other women living at the time of mitochondrial Eve. And we all in our bodies carry genes from all of those other people who were alive at those times as well. So although there's a particular genes that can be traced back to one person, and you can see that connection, there's actually many other humans who were alive at the time of both of those figures. So it does suggest, you know, the genetic evidence does point towards the unity of the human race. There's a lot more genetic similarity among humans than among other species. We're descended from a fairly small original population, but that's about as far as the evidence actually goes.
Yeah, the evidence is consistent with all of us being descended from one man and one woman, but doesn't prove that we're descended from one man and one woman. And probably the biggest change in the last year is that the dates that we thought we were getting from the DNA are nowhere near as accurate as had been presumed 5 and 6 years ago. In fact, it's basically not much help anymore, where you come in with dates like 150,000 years ago, plus or minus 150,000 years, where we used to think we had dates that were good to plus or minus 4,000 years. So it's kind of a sobering within the discipline that we're probably not going to get the kinds of accurate dates that we had hoped for. But I'm also old enough to remember when the whole anthropological picture was very much different from what the Bible proposed. Then you began to see in the literature that they were talking about what they called the Garden of Eden hypothesis, that we come from one location. They began talking about Eve and about Adam. And what's interesting is that for the first time, the scientific literature was using biblical terms to describe the story of human origins. And so that was encouraging to me 20 years ago, just to see this transition from a very anti-Christian perspective on human origins, where they now seem compelled to use biblical terminology. But I do agree with Deborah that we don't have an accurate picture yet. And also, as I look at the data, I'm not certain we're ever going to be able to resolve this with scientific certainty. We don't have any good radiometric dating tools for the dates we're interested in. So we may always be stuck with a certain measure of uncertainty. And you know, we discussed this afternoon. The genetics has got a long ways to go before we have any kind of certain conclusions. And there needs to be a lot more work done. And I think that's one thing that our two organizations can do as we work with one another, is basically suggest experiments that can be done to put to the test the different positions that we have. And so I'm really looking forward to, hopefully, people being able to engage in studies that literally have been ignored for decades.
Well, this kind of ties into what you've just mentioned. As far as our domains of knowledge, there seems to be certain gaps. You mentioned two, one where prebiotics would occur, and one during the Big Bang. With both of those holes in our knowledge, you've posited divine intervention. Of course, throughout the entire process, I'm sure you believe that it is guided by God. Why do you choose these two instances to insert divine intervention as opposed to just unknowns that we should be comfortable with until we collect more scientific information?
Yeah, the origin of life is a good example, and that often you hear within science that the absence of evidence is not evidence for absence. But sometimes the evidence becomes so compelling that it actually is. And the origin of life is a classic example where that is actually beginning to develop. Even people who are not believers in God are arguing that we clearly have a lack of any naturalistic explanation, even possible. There isn't even a scenario today that's been proposed to work. And so say we actually see this progressively at these different origin of life research conferences. The very fact that we don't see any sugars There is no ribose or dextrose seen anywhere in the universe or on Earth outside of biological systems. We don't see the homochiral molecules anywhere outside of biological systems. We don't even see the possibility of a mechanism that would produce any degree of homochirality. So these are major issues. If you can't line up the amino acids all left-handed or the ribose sugars all right-handed, there's no way you can put these systems together. The very fact that we can't even do this in the lab, I mean, people have been trying to link together nucleotides and these amino acids in the lab. And you can get up to about 47, 48 isomers linked together. When you get that far, you can't pull it off the substrate. It becomes an adhesive. And so you just can't get past that limit. And so that, you know, and the fact that we have evidence that the origin of life takes place in a geologic instant. So it happens extremely quickly without any prebiotics being available. I mean, one thing that was brought up at an Origin of Life research conference is what they call the oxygen ultraviolet paradox. If there's oxygen in the Earth's environment, that prevents these prebiotic molecules from forming. If you don't have oxygen, the ultraviolet radiation from the sun stops the prebiotic chemistry. So if you got oxygen, it can't happen. If you don't have oxygen, it can't happen. And if you don't have prebiotic building blocks, you don't have a naturalistic model that's even conceivable for the origin of life. So this is why we feel compelled to say there must be a supernatural answer to this, because we really have ruled out all reasonable naturalistic explanations for the event. And likewise, on the origin of the universe, there is a theorem produced by Arvind Bordé, Alexander Vilenkin, and Alan Guth, which basically makes the point that if general relativity reliably describes the dynamics of bodies in the universe, then even in the case of all conceivable inflationary Big Bang models, the universe has a beginning that implies a beginning of time itself. And Alexander Vilenkin wrote a book on this 2 years after they published their theorem, where he basically said cosmologists have no possible escape. They have to face up to the fact that there's a beginning. They have to deal with the problem of a cosmic beginning. And that problem, of course, is the causal agent beyond time that brought it into existence. So those are a couple of examples. We've got whole books on this subject that you can read, and we have more than just those two examples.
Something that I heard this afternoon that I don't think I've heard this evening regarding the differences of reasons to believe would emphasize, I believe, a divine designer, and biologos, I believe, would emphasize a biological ancestor. Designer versus ancestor.
Are you thinking common design versus common ancestry? Yeah, we can talk about that a little bit. So this is referring to the similarities between creatures. So both of our organizations would accept that some creatures have very similar body plans, for instance. I think this afternoon we talked about wings and bats and birds and so forth. And why are they similar? Is that because of, at Biologos, sometimes the similarities are due to common ancestry. So bats and birds do not have common ancestry. It's a different case. So there is similarities, though, say, between humans and chimpanzees. There is a tremendous genetic similarity, similarity of body plans. And when you trace back the genetic similarities, you see they are similar even in the broken genes. They are similar in ways that point to a chain of genetic changes that point to a common ancestor that we have shared between us and other primates. So we would say that it's common ancestry, that these creatures are truly related to each other. Then there are instances like the bats have wings and birds have wings, but most mammals don't have wings. How did that arise? And there we would, there's this idea of convergent evolution, that there's a lot of features that have arose through evolution at different times in the evolutionary history, because there are similar constraints. If you want to fly, you're going to end up with wings. That's the best way to fly. I was at the SeaWorld, and I remember seeing, well, here are mammals swimming along. There's the dolphins. Here are birds swimming along. We have got the penguins. And here are fish swimming along, and they all have a very similar body plan, because swimming in cold, icy water, that's the kind of body plan you need. So there's that convergent evolution because it's fitting with the constraints of the environment, and some great ideas just keep arising. So.
Right, and the difference is that we would look at that as evidence for common design rather than common descent. So rather than this being a feature where they're related through an evolutionary process to a common ancestor, it's like the creator steps in and says, this is an optimal design, I'm going to use it more than once. One of the more dramatic examples of that would be the chameleon and the sand lance living in totally different environments, not related to one another in any kind of evolutionary tree, and yet they got identical design features, not just in one organ, but in multiple organs. And so you got the sand lance that lives on the bottom of the ocean, and it's got the same eye structure, same eyelids, same tongue structure as this creature that's a reptile that lives in the desert, and the same hunting strategy that it's using. And you could argue maybe the environmental pressures would be producive, but the environmental pressures are very different. And you don't see other animals in the same environment with the same equipment. It's just the one chameleon and the one sand lance. And just to give you an idea, these are creatures that have this incredible spring-loaded tongue, where the tongue is kind of coiled up, and the eyes, unlike our human eyes, can move independently of one another, and therefore they can track motion very carefully. But one's tracking motion in the ocean, relatively slow, the other is tracking motion in the air, relatively fast, and yet they use the two different eye motions to track the thing, and then this spring-loaded tongue zips out and grabs the creature. It's got the same glue-like structure in the tongue, and then the eyelids are the same, and the focusing structure of the eyes is not like ours at all. And so we see these unique features, but they're identical in both creatures. Now, when I presented this to people who are not theistic in their interpretation of biology, their answer is coincidence. I say, okay, but this isn't the only example we have. My colleague Fuzz Rana has documented over 1,000 examples of similar cases of identical design outcomes. And the idea that this could happen through some naturalistic evolutionary process thousands of times just doesn't seem to be a rational approach. And when it comes to particularly the mammals, in our dialogue with BioLogos, we've been appealing to conservation biology, which basically documents if you've got mammals that have an adult body size more than 3 kilograms, they go extinct before they can experience any significant evolutionary change. All the bipedal primate species have adult body sizes way bigger than 3 kilograms. What was interesting is that attending a conference where the guy is an atheist, Ian Tattersall, but he basically came to my colleague Fuzz Rana and says, I want to share something with you that I think will help your model. And his whole point is, he says, notice that these bipedal primates are missing in Australia, North America, and South America. We only find them in Africa, Europe, and Asia. Then he says, notice what happened when humans invaded Australia. Very quickly, they drove to extinction 94% of the large-bodied and bird mammal species. Sub-Saharan Africa had all the bipedal primates, nearly a dozen different species we've found so far. The extinction rate when humans entered Africa was only 4.5%. And says, also notice with these bipedal primates, as you go forward in history, each next species is a little more efficient at hunting large-bodied bird and mammal species. And Neanderthals, for example, that was their exclusive diet. And so they would have been the best before we human beings came along, which is why we've built into our human origins model that God specially created all of these bipedal primate species, knowing that we would sin, and knowing we would be in danger of wiping out the very animals we needed for civilization. and therefore train these creatures through the introduction of these bipedal primates to watch out when you see big creatures on two legs with sticks in their hands, run away rather than run up to them. And what you notice is in Australia, North America, and South America, nothing passes Stone Age civilization, and the population never got very large. They lacked the animals they needed to launch and sustain technology in a high population.
Well, I think that's all the time that we have. We can still ask some questions afterwards. Please look at your evaluation forms. That would be really helpful if you can drop them off in the cardboard box on the way out. And also, there's a lot of materials to buy to look through in the back. But let's thank our speakers for their event.